Good morning to everyone, and thank you for taking the time to be here. So this is the fourth session in our masterclass series for 2021. My name's Jendra John Xavier, and I'm a marketing analyst with Service Desk Plus. And today we're going to be looking at five hacks to implement an effective asset management in your organization. Let's look at what the agenda is for today. So today we're going to be looking at how you can build an accurate repository of all your assets. So basically how you're going to bring in all the different kinds of assets that are in your organization into your Service Desk Plus application. Next up, we're going to see how you can create an asset lifecycle to track all your assets throughout their entire lifecycle. So I think that we can all agree that an asset has a lifecycle, right? So it goes from when it is procured, and then your asset is assigned to someone, so it is in use, and sometimes it is in storage, sometimes your assets need to be repaired, and finally you are getting rid of your assets once they are expired or you cannot use it anymore. So you need to track your assets throughout this entire life cycle. Next up, we're going to see how you can utilize your assets effectively by collecting necessary and relevant information about your hardware assets, your software assets, and how you loan out your assets efficiently to people on a temporary basis, and basically how you can utilize your assets effectively. Next up, we are going to see how you can optimize your asset procurement using purchase orders and contracts. And finally, how you can optimize your entire asset management process and how you can connect your IT asset management to your ITSM process to build a holistic environment in your organization. Okay, so these are the five hacks we'll be looking at today. So now, for those of you who are not aware of what asset management is, asset management is a systematic process of managing all your assets across their entire lifecycle. Like I previously said, assets have a life cycle, and with asset management, you're systematically managing all your assets, and not only are you managing them, but you also track them across their entire life cycle. Now, asset management is not limited to just tracking and managing, but it also helps you reduce costs, optimize asset usage across your organization, at the same time while staying compliant as well. So that is what asset management is. Okay, so now we're going to be looking at a use case, and we're going to take Zilker's instance for this particular session. So if you have been with us for the previous three sessions, you should be pretty familiar with who Zilker is. Now, Zilker is the organization that so far we have helped with setting up an incident management process. We've helped them transform their change enablement, and also we help them set up a successful employee onboarding process with their service request. So previously we saw how we set up the employee onboarding process, and this time we're going to be seeing how, now that Zilker is onboarding their employees, we're going to see how they're efficiently procuring assets and providing these new employees the assets that they need. Now, a bit of a background of Zilker in case you're not, you haven't attended our previous sessions. Zilker is an organization that is currently working on a remote basis due to the pandemic, just like many of us have been working or are still working in a remote basis. So as a result, they had to completely transform the way they manage their entire ITSM. And as a result, we saw them transform many of the IT processes. And this time we're looking at how they can set up and implement an effective IT asset management process. Now, Zilker is rapidly hiring new employees, and they are now struggling to provide assets to these new hires. And they are struggling because they do not have a proper asset management process in place, and as a result, they hit a major roadblock. Now, let's look at some of the challenges that Zilker is facing. So the first challenge that Zilker is facing is the inability to track asset usage. Now, Zilker knows that they have about 100 workstations, but they're not able to track how many workstations are being used by employees and how many assets or workstations can be assigned to the new highest. Next up, they find it difficult to track their purchase orders and their vendor contracts because they do not have an organized and systematic method to track these items. So as a result, they are not able to stay on top of all their orders. Next up, we see that they find it difficult to scan in all the different kinds of assets. Now, if you're anyone who's familiar with an organization or IT, you know that there are a variety of different assets that are in any IT environment, right? Now, Zilka is struggling to bring in all the different kinds of assets, both IT, non-IT assets, workstations, switches, and so on, right? So we're going to see how they can overcome that. Next up, Zilka also struggles to track software licenses. And as a result, it's very hard for them to be software compliant, meaning that there are cases where they are under-licensed or over-licensed. And also there is the chance that their software license are getting expired, which in turn can affect an employee's user's workflow when one of their software is unavailable. Next up, Zilka is also struggling to optimize their asset usage. And finally, there is no way for them to generate reports on assets to collect important metrics about their own asset management process. And as a result of this, they are unable to continuously improve their asset management process and also show the organization the impact of their IT asset management process and get other useful metrics like the number of assets that they have. And also they struggle to face audits because they don't have all the necessary information about their assets. Okay, so now let's look at how Zilka can overcome all of these challenges. So we have five simple asset management hacks that can help Zilka. So the first one is building an accurate repository of all their assets. So we're going to see how Zilka can bring in all the different kinds of assets that are in their organization into their Service Desk Plus application. Next up, we're going to see how they can create an asset lifecycle to track all their assets and see what states their assets are in. Next up, we're going to see how they can utilize their assets effectively by collecting relevant and necessary information about both hardware assets and software assets and how they can manage these assets effectively with that information. Next up, we're going to see how you can optimize asset procurement using purchase orders and contracts. And finally, the final hack is how they can optimize their asset management process and how they can connect their IT asset management process to their ITSM processes to build a holistic environment in their organization. Okay, so now we're going to go and look at all of these hacks in detail. So the first hack is building an accurate repository of all your assets. This hack, like I said earlier, is just about how you're going to bring in all the data into your Service Desk Plus application. Only with the data that you bring in can you actually track and manage your assets. Without the data, IT asset management just cannot function, right? So that is the first and most important step. Now, there is a variety of different ways through which you can scan in your assets. So the first and the most fundamental way through which you can do it is through probes. So most of the main scans that we use, which is the domain scan, the network scan, and the SCCM integration, all work on the probe that you install onto your servers. So it's important that you set up your probe properly. Next up is the SCCM integration and our barcode scans as well. And we have a couple of other scans too. So now let's go ahead and look at each of these scans in detail and see how you can set them up. So give me a second while I share the screen so that you can see the product. I hope you can all see the Service Desk Plus application. Off the bat, we are greeted with a familiar screen, or at least I hope this is a familiar screen for you. So this is our home tab where we have our dashboards over here. So these dashboards just quickly give you all the information that you need in one glance. And the best part is, they are graphical representations, which make it very easy to identify information. So this is the asset dashboard that we have. You can actually set up you can select different kinds of dashboards, and these dashboards are completely customizable. Okay, now getting back to the topic, we were talking about assets and the different kinds of scans, right? So let's go and look at the different scan types that are available to us. So I'm going to go ahead and move to the assets tab over here. And I'm going to tell you, so this is where we can look at all the different assets that we have in the application. So these are all the assets that I've scanned and brought into Service Desk Plus. So you can see how easy it is for me to manage and track all of them, right? So now let's look at how you can add a new asset. So the easiest and the most simplest way to do it is by manually adding an asset. So you just click on a new asset, add the name, the various details about this asset, like the hardware details, the process details, the state, input, output devices, etc. So this is the most basic way you can do it. So if you're adding maybe one or two assets, this won't be much of a hassle. But let's say you're trying to add about 100 or 200 assets, this is just not feasible, right? So in those cases, you can also use a CSV file to import your asset data. So you can go ahead, choose the CSV file, and you can also choose which rows or columns you want to the data from those columns to be imported into Service Desk Plus. So this way you can easily and quickly import a large number of assets into Service Desk Plus. But the way I would recommend you to scan your assets is through the various scanning methods we have. The benefit of using these scanning methods is they can bring in a variety of asset information into Service Desk Plus, so you don't have to manually enter them. So now let's look at the different scanning techniques available to us. So I'm going to quickly jump to setup, the setup page, and then I'm going to scroll down to probes and discovery. So I'm going to click on probes and discovery. And I'm greeted with the probes menu over here. So this is where you can configure a probe and download the probe as well. So you can add the name of the probe and choose which site you want this probe to be installed in. And then you can go ahead, download the particular probe you want. And then you can go ahead and install this probe on, let's say, one of your servers. So it's important that you install your probe in a place where it can ping all the different assets that you want to scan and bring into Service Desk Plus. So it should be in a place where it can easily access all the other assets. Only then you can scan them. So like I said, most of the other scans rely on this probe to ping the assets and get the information when they scan them. So now that we know how the probe is set up, let's quickly go and look at the two main scans that we have. The first one is the domain scan. Now, this scan is all about, is mainly used to scan Windows devices. But again, it's not limited only to Windows devices. Any device on this domain, you can scan it. So you can go ahead and configure your new domain scan over here. Select the probe. Like I said, it depends on the probe to ping the assets and get the information. You can add the domain name, the domain controller, the credentials, choose all the other different configurations that you want over here. And you can choose to enable software scan for these different kinds of assets as well. So this is the domain scan, and this is where you configure it. Next up, we have the network scan. Now, the network scan is primarily used to scan any other kind of asset you have in your organization, like your Mac devices, your Linux devices, and your other SNMP enabled devices as well. And setting up the network scan is also pretty easy. You can just select which network you want to scan. It could be the entire network, or you can also specify specific range that you want to scan. And you can also choose to exclude devices from this scan as well. You're gonna go ahead and select the probe you want to use for the scan. Add the description and choose the credentials for the different kinds of assets that you want to scan. So now, and also you have the ability to enable software scan for these different devices as well. So now let's imagine you're setting up various different network scans. It can be quite cumbersome to add the credentials over and over again, right? Don't worry, we thought about that and we've given you a credential library where you can go ahead and record all the credentials. It's basically a repository of all the credentials, and you can just easily choose a credential from this library and easily add it to your network scan and configure your scan. Next up, we have the SCCM integration. So for those of you who use Microsoft SCCM, this is great news because you can integrate Service Desk Plus with SCCM to bring in, to import the asset data that Microsoft SCCM has collected. So you can go ahead, add the details over here, and then choose the probe with which you want to import this data. And that's how you set up your SCCM integration. This is just another way you can bring in the assets you need into Service Desk Plus. Next up, we have our settings over here. So over here, you can come and configure your general settings. You can enable, disable MAC addresses, select the workstation name format, and also choose to clean up scan history older than a specific period of time. Next up, we have the Exclude Devices tab over here. Over here, you can come and choose certain devices that you want to exclude during a scan. Next up, we have the unknown OID. So basically, whenever a probe is unable to identify an SNMP-enabled device, that particular asset or device would be recorded over here. And then you can go ahead and add a new object identifier for it so that the next time the probe scans this asset, it will get the information over from here and it will no longer be an unknown asset. And finally, we have ScanScript. Now, ScanScript is pretty interesting because you can download the self-scan script and run it on your own machine. So why this is important is, let's say your workstation is outside the office network and the probe is unable to reach this particular workstation, you can run this scan script and you can send the information about your workstation directly to Service Desk Plus Cloud. Over here, you can select the key and you can add it so that it's securely done. Now, in Zilker's case, this self-scan is pretty important because they are working from home, right? Zilker, most of the employees. And in case they are unable to reach the office network and the probe is unable to ping their devices, they can run this self-scan script and send the information about their asset directly to Service Desk Plus. So now we've seen a variety of different scanning methods through which Zilker can collect all the necessary information about their data and bring in all their different kinds of assets into Service Desk Plus. And finally, we also have the barcode scan. So you can use a barcode scan to scan the barcode of any asset and collect the information that is there in that barcode to add their details into Service Desk Plus. And not only that, you can also generate and create your new or your own barcodes to track your assets through barcode as well if you need it. So that is pretty much brings us to the end of the first hack, which is all about building an accurate repository of all your assets. Now, Zilker has brought in all their assets into Service Desk Plus so that they can go ahead and manage these assets. So the hack number two is about creating an asset lifecycle to track all your assets. So like I previously told you, each asset has a lifecycle because an asset, it just does not exist in your organization, right? It's either being used by an employee or it is in storage, or in certain cases, it is under repair. So it's currently not being used by anyone. And certain assets are expired, and as a result, they need to be disposed of. So we see that there are various stages that your asset passes through, or various statuses that they go through. So it's important that you track them. Now, why is it important that you track them? Let's jump back to Zilker and see an example. Now, Zilker, they are hiring new employees. Let's say they hired 10 new employees. And in their organization, they have a neat list of, so they're scanned in their assets, and now they have a list of 100 workstations that they have in their organization. But now they hit a roadblock because they don't know how many of these assets are being used by users, and how many of these workstations are available to be assigned to these new employees. And this is why Zilker needs asset states so that they can track what the state of each asset is. Okay, so now this might sound a bit complicated, but don't worry, it's really simple. I'm going to show you how you can configure your asset states. And also, I'm going to show you a couple of other benefits these asset states give you. So now let's go back to Service Desk Plus and let's head back to assets. So I'm just going to click on IT assets over here. And right over here, in each of these cards, right? It's very easy for me to read, and I can easily track how many of my assets are in use and how many of my assets are in store or what their state is. So over here, if in Zirka's case, let's say I'm a technician at Zirka, I go over to the workstations and I can see that this many workstations are being in use, and I can see how many are in store. And now I know that I can actually go ahead and assign these workstations to the new employees, right? So you can see how it makes life a little bit easier for me, because I can track the states of these different of these assets. And how do I set up these states? Very simple. Let's jump back to setup, go down to customization, and head over to asset management. And over here, we can see seven different tabs. So I'll explain what these six different tabs are a little bit later. Right now, let's just look at the asset state. So over here, we see that there are seven asset states that I currently have configured. So we can see disposed, expired, in repair, in store, in use, and so on. And the best part is I can add new asset states and I can customize all my asset states. So the reason we're giving you this customization is because we know each organization has completely unique requirements. And as a result, we don't want you to be limited to just these asset states. And we have given you the complete freedom to set up the asset states that the way you want for your own organization. So this is where you're going to set up these asset states. And by clicking on the workstations, let's look at the workstations over here. I can also easily see what the state of each workstation is right from here. And it makes things a lot easier for me. A couple of other ways these asset states are important is when you're collecting metrics. Now let's take, for example, let's take this as an example itself. So we see that we have 16 workstations in use, and we see that we have 130 workstations in store. Now, this definitely means that I have way more workstations than I actually need, right? So by collecting these metrics, I can actually go ahead and optimize the assets I have in my organization, and I can streamline them so that I don't have so many workstations in store. So I can go ahead and get rid of some of the workstations. So basically, we can see how efficient our IT asset management is by tracking these metrics. Another example is if, let's say we have about 50 workstations that are in repair, we can quickly create a problem ticket to identify the root cause of why so many of these workstations are not working properly. And maybe we could identify that if it's a defect from the manufacturer, and you can see how that can help you as well, right? And also finally, you can run various reports to collect these metrics as well. So one is by using these dashboards, you can create custom widgets to collect various information like based on asset states, and you can also run reports. You can select any one of the multiple out-of-box reports that we have to collect the asset management metrics, or you can go ahead and create custom reports to get really drilled down information that you want about your asset management. So you can go select your asset management as the module and then run a custom report as. So that is the hack about creating an asset lifecycle to track your assets. And we see how this can bring a lot of benefit to your organization as well, right? So that's hack number two. Now let's jump to hack number three, which is utilizing your assets effectively. So how can you utilize your assets effectively? So we're going to see how you can classify all your assets for easy tracking, how you're going to manage both your hardware assets and your software assets. Now, hardware assets and software assets have a different set of requirements, right? There is different information that you need to collect for each of them, and also there's different ways in which you need to handle them. So I'm going to show you the different information that you can collect for them so that you can utilize them effectively. Next up, we're going to also see how you can monitor your software licenses and ensure that you are allocating your software licenses properly, and also ensure that you stay compliant so that your organization is completely compliant and you are not breaching any compliance laws as well. And finally, we are also going to see how a simple feature called asset loaning can help you become a lot more efficient by tracking the assets that you are providing to users on a temporary basis. So this feature ensures that you give your whenever you give your assets on a temporary basis, you're also collecting them on time so that none of your assets are getting misplaced or you're not losing any of your assets. Now let's go ahead and look at each of these features and the different capabilities available in Service Desk to help you utilize your assets effectively. Okay, so now let's head back to the Assets tab. And over here, we can see that all the assets are very neatly arranged under different categories, right? So this makes life so much easier for me because I don't have one jumbled list of assets, but I have all my assets neatly arranged under their different categories, which makes it so much easier to track and manage them. And not only my hardware assets, but I can also set up different categories for my software assets, my software, my licenses as well. So now we have all these categories. It looks pretty cool. But now let's say you might have a doubt. Okay, I don't see a particular hardware category over here, and I would like to add a new category. So how do you do that? It's very simple. Don't worry, let me show you where you can do that. So now if you go back to the Setup tab and under Customizations and Asset Management, over here we can, if you remember, I told you that there are these six other tabs, right? So now let's go ahead and look at each of these tabs. So the first one is the product type. So this is where you can come and add different kinds of product types. Like if you were someone who was wondering, how do I add a new product type? This is where you can come and do it. So you just click on new product type, select the product type name, choose what type of product is this. Is it an asset, a component, or a consumable? Choose the category, if it's IT or non-IT, add a description. And then you can select any one of the given icons over here, or you can import an image and add your own custom icon as well. And that is how you create a new product type. You can also create new products and add them over here. So you can choose a category product name and you can add different kinds of vendors associated with each of these products right over here. And you can also add and configure depreciation for these different products as well. Next up, you can record any of your vendors over here. Let's say Dell is one of your vendors. You can choose to add them over here. Next up, we have our software types. So over here, you can create new kinds of software. Let's say if you have a managed software, you can add it over here. So these are the different software types that come out of the box. And you can also choose to add new kinds of software types as well. So we have excluded, freeware, managed software, prohibited software, etc. And like I said, you can completely add your own new software types as well. You can add new software categories to record what kind of software they are and what the software is used for. And then we also have different software license types. There are different kinds of software licenses, and you can add multiple different new software licenses as well. So you have a bunch of them which come out of the box. You can also add your own new license types. So now the reason we have given so much customization for you is we know and acknowledge that each organization has their own requirements, right? So we don't want you to fit to our mold, but we want to allow you to customize Service Desk Plus to fit your requirements. So over here, you can use all of these tabs and options for you to create your own customizations and set up your IT asset management categories and software types, product names based on your organization's requirements. Okay, so that is the first point. So now we're going to go and look at each of these assets and look at the information available for each of them. So now when you're handling, let's take a workstation, for example, When you're handling a workstation, I'll show you all the information that you can collect for each workstation. So when you click on a workstation, right off the bat, you're greeted with this general details view tab, and over here you can get the general details of your asset, like the name, the model, the operating system, the cost, when it was purchased, last updated time, updated by whom, etc., who it's assigned to as well. And over here on this card on the right hand side, you can see who it is assigned to, and you can also see all the associated tickets to this particular asset. So we can see that there are 4 changes that are associated to this asset. You can also see associated problems and even incidents as well. So how this helps us, let's say if there are 10 incidents associated to this particular asset, you can, it's safe to come to the conclusion that maybe this particular asset might be a problem asset, and it might be high time to go ahead and replace this asset, right? So you get all that kind of information as well. So under the hardware tab, you're going to find all the hardware information about this particular asset. Information like the OS information, the memory, the processor, the installed memory modules, the network details, disks, drives, physical drives, printer details, and so on, right? So it's a large number of information that you, hardware information that you can collect for each asset. And this helps you manage them better when you know what kind of assets you have in your organization. All you have to do is just click on your asset and you can easily identify the specifications for that particular asset. And under the software tab, you can see all the software that is installed on this particular workstation. So when you scan your workstations, you're also scanning your software details as well. So we can see that this is all the software that has been added, that has been installed in this particular asset. Okay, so you can get all your software details over here. And if there's any virtual machine that is associated to this asset, you can add the details over here and view them here. Next up is the relationships tab. Now, this is a pretty important tab because you can view all your asset relationships right from here. So over here, we can see that this particular asset is assigned to Mark Canaway, and we can see the different assets and components attached to this particular asset. And we can also see the assets and the business services that this asset is connected to. So now this gives you a bird's eye view of all the relationships and the impact of this particular asset on your IT infrastructure. So now when there's something that goes wrong, you can also identify if the reason for the workstation to not function properly is directly from the workstation, or if it is related to any of the connected or attached assets as well. So basically, under the relationships tab, you can easily identify all the relationships of this particular asset. The contracts tab basically just records any contracts that is associated to this particular workstation. Let's say you have an annual maintenance cost contract with the vendor for this particular asset. You can associate it and get the information right from within here. And we have the financials tab, which is very self-explanatory. So basically, you can add the purchase cost of this particular asset, and you can get all the financials details. And also, you can configure depreciation over here. You can choose the and specify what kind of depreciation method you want to track the value of this asset from the throughout its entire life cycle. And finally, the history tab basically shows you any activities or any actions that were performed on this particular asset at any time throughout its entire life cycle. And the state history shows you the different states that this particular asset has gone through. So basically, the history tab just gives you that extra bit of accountability when you know who did what change to your assets. Okay, so that's the information that you can collect on your asset. And if you notice, just by clicking on one asset, you can get so much information about your asset, which can help you a lot. So now let's go ahead and look at a software asset and let's see the information that you can collect for your software assets and how you can manage them. So I'm just going to go ahead and click on scanned software. And over here, you can see the different software that has been scanned. You can look at, you can get the information about the manufacturer, the category, the type of software this is. This is where we see what software is a managed software, what is unidentified. You can also add prohibited software. You can mark certain software as prohibited. And whenever the application scans a prohibited software, it can notify you that, hey, there is a workstation with a prohibited software installed on it, right? So it can notify you. So over here, we can see also the information about how many installations are there, how many are licensed installations, how many are purchased, how many installations are allowed, how many are allocated, available for allocation, and also the compliance type. So right over here, we can see how much, how many of the software is compliant, how many are under licensed or over licensed. So now let's go ahead and click on any one of the software we have over here, and then we'll see all the information available for it. So I'm going to click on the Microsoft Office Outlook MUI software over here, and we immediately see that this particular software is over-licensed in one site. And over here, we get the details, the general details of the software. And on the right-hand side on this card, we can see how many licenses are purchased, how many installations are allowed, how many are allowed right over here. So this gives you a gist of this particular software and where it is allocated to. So now we click on license agreement and we can see if any license agreement is associated to this particular software. So we'll look at this software license agreement in just a little bit. So over here under installations, you can see the workstations in which this particular software has been installed in. And we can see how many of these installations have licenses associated and how many do not have a license associated. Next up, we can see the number of licenses that are available for this particular software. So we see that we have one purchased license over here. We also see that one license is available for allocation, and you can also add downgrade license information here as well. So under here, we can look at who is using this particular software. So we can see that two users are using, and you can also associate software to departments as well. And under the history tab, you can look at all the actions that was performed on this particular software, where it was installed, where it was updated, and where it was uninstalled as well. So now let's go back to the license agreement and look at this in detail. So you can create a license agreement and you can associate multiple licenses with this license agreement. So I have this license agreement with Microsoft Corporation, and I see I have purchased one license for them, which is an enterprise agreement license for 5 installations. So we have the general details about this license agreement, and we have this license over here. So let me click on the license. And when I click on this license, I can see the license details over here, where it is allocated to, and I can allocate or deallocate this license right from here. And if there's any contract associated to this license, I can add the details over here. And just by clicking on this tab, I can see if there's any contracts associated to this particular software license. So this is how you can actually manage your software and the licenses of your software to ensure that you stay compliant. Now, at this particular software that we saw, that software was over-licensed, which meant that there was one extra license available. So I can go ahead and allocate that license to a new workstation, or in the future, I can reduce the number of licenses that I purchase so that I am staying efficient and I'm using my license in the most optimal way. Okay, so that is all the information that you can collect for your scanned software. We also have an asset replenishment feature as well. So you can choose, you can add a new replenishment configuration, and you can choose to notify yourself whenever let's say a smartphone of this particular product, and whenever it is below 10 in the store state, you can choose to notify you so that you can replenish your asset stock. So this is just another quick way to ensure that you are you're never caught in a situation where you need to immediately procure assets in a short-term notice. So this way you can ensure that there are always a few assets in store for you to quickly assign whenever necessary. So now let's go ahead and look at the asset loan feature. Now, this is a very simple feature, but this can really help you a lot if you are an organization which is loaning assets or providing assets on a temporary basis. So over here, we're first going to look at loanable assets. So over here, you can choose certain assets and mark them as loanable assets. So now let's say you don't want every kind of all the assets in your organization to be made available to be associated or loaned on a temporary basis, right? You might have certain assets that are of high value that you don't want to be given on a temporary basis. So what you can do is you can set aside few assets that are going to be that can be marked as loanable assets. This ensures that your important assets are not accidentally loaned to anyone on a temporary basis even. So now let's go back to the loan registry. Now that we have set our loanable assets, you can create a new loan. You can select an asset from the loanable assets that you have marked as loanable, and then you can choose the time period of this asset, choose who it is loaned to, whether a user or a department, mark the site, and also mark who received this particular asset, and you can go ahead and save and create a new loan. So now over here, you can look at all your asset loans in one place. So we see that these are all the loans that have been closed. And if you look at this particular loan, we see that it is expiring in 48 days. So it will notify you that the asset loan is nearing expiry, and you can choose to renew the loan or get the asset from the user. So over here, we see that this particular loan has expired 58 days ago. So now you know you need to either get back the assets from them, or you can mark it as, or you can renew the contract. So right now you know that you have not taken the asset back from the user. So this helps you keep track of your assets so that none of them are lost in limbo, right? So now that is how you can efficiently utilize your assets in your organization with the right information to manage them, and also using asset loans, you can efficiently loan them out to your end users on a temporary basis or to temporary employees as well. So that brings us to the end of hack number three. Let's jump to hack number four, which is optimizing your asset procurement by leveraging purchase orders and contracts. Now, in Zilker's case itself, we see that they allow Zilker to hire 10 new employees. And based on the asset states, they identify that they have 5 assets that are in store. So they're going to assign those 5 workstations to the new employees. But now they see that they still need 5 more workstations. So how do they track the process of getting these workstations that can be done using a purchase order? Now, as anyone who has been in an organization, you're fully aware of how difficult it is to purchase a new item, right? So it needs to go through the right channels. It needs to get the right permissions and approvals before you can purchase a new asset in your organization. Similarly, in Zilker's case, they didn't have a way to manage and track their purchase orders. And as a result, they found it hard to stay on top of all of these requests. So now with purchase orders, we are going to see how you can track your purchase orders centrally and how you can associate your purchase orders to service requests to track them easily, set up multiple levels of approvals for your purchase orders, and finally, how you can use contracts and associate assets and software license to track your contracts as well. So let's head over back to Service Desk Plus, and now let's go to the Purchases tab first. So I'm gonna move to Purchases tab over here, and let me select one of, so right over here, I can see a list of purchase orders. So I've currently set the filter to all approved purchase orders, So you can select the filter from here. You can choose all purchase orders or whatever you need to see at the moment. So I'm just going to go and click on one of these purchase orders over here. So now I'm selecting this purchase order, and over here I can see all the details of this purchase order, like the vendor details, shipping details, billing address, shipping address. I can add the product that I want purchased, the quantity. I can add the information like the tax rate and other information, discount, sales cost, shipping cost, etc. Add the general information about this purchase order. I can set up multiple levels of approvals so that only after these approvals are received, I can go ahead and purchase this asset. I can add invoice details, payment details, and the history tab. Again, just records all the actions performed on this particular purchase order. And over here, I can track them all centrally, so that's easy for me to track them. I can also see the purchase order status right from here. So you can create a new purchase order and add all the different details right over here. So you can add discount details, shipping costs, sales tax rates, etc. right over here. And it makes it so much easy for you to create a purchase order and track all the details necessary for a purchase order. And another cool feature is you can attach these purchase orders directly to a service request right from here. Or you can also do it from within the service request as well. So now in the case of Zilka, let's take this as an example. So now in this onboarding request, what you can do is, or what Zilka can do is, the technician, he can create a task where one of the tasks could be check the store if we have enough workstations for all the employees. The technician can go ahead, look at the store, and if he identifies that they don't have enough workstations, what he can do is he can go ahead and add a task titled procure need new workstations, or we need to purchase new workstations, or whatever title he wants to give. Add the scheduled start, the scheduled end date, and he can assign it to the purchaser's team. So, and he can assign it to them, and he can create this task. Now the task has been created and assigned to the purchaser's team. Now the purchaser's team can review this request for a new asset, and they can go ahead and create a purchase order. So they can go ahead, create a purchase order, and once they created it, they can mark their task as completed. Now the technician, he can look at the task and see that it's completed. Now all he has to do is just go ahead and associate the purchase order. So he's gonna go and click on attach purchase order, and he can, let's go select our purchase order. So he can go select the Dell Workstations purchase order, and he can attach it right from here. So we can see in one easy way that we have brought different departments together, different people together, and we made this entire process streamlined. So now the employee onboarding ticket has been created, and you can track this ticket right from its creation all the way till when the purchase order has been created and this asset has been assigned to the new employee. So now we see that we have streamlined the entire process for Zilka, so that's easy for them to not only assign their workstation to the new employee, but also track the purchase orders as well. So that's how purchase orders work. Now let's look at how contracts work. Contracts, again, is very simple, similar to purchase orders. Centrally, you can track all your contracts. So over here, I have this annual maintenance contract that I have with the Computer Enterprises vendor. So this contract is all about how this vendor is going to provide support for maintenance of servers in Zilka. So now I can add the details of my contract, and I can associate assets and software license to this particular contract, and they will show up in this particular asset when you look at the contract details. So over here, we see that this particular asset has been associated to this contract. So when I click on this asset details, I see this contract under the contracts tab that we saw earlier when we were looking at a hardware asset. Similarly for software licenses as well, if it has been associated over here. So whenever you renew the contract, you can add the renewal details over here to mark when it was renewed and what the contract cost and et cetera, and the period of this renewal was. You can add multiple contract relationships like child and parent relationships. And finally, the history tab just records any actions performed on this particular contract. So that is how contracts work. And that brings us to the end of the fourth hack, which is, so we saw how you can use purchase orders and contracts to optimize your asset procurement and track them easily in one place. So now finally on to our final hack, which is optimizing your asset management as a whole. So in this hack, we're going to be seeing how you can map your workstations to end users and why it is important. We're going to look at the CMDB and how it gives you a bird's eye view of your entire IT infrastructure, the importance of associating your assets to the different relevant incidents, problems, and changes. And finally, we are going to be looking at different integrations available to you in Service Desk Plus. So now let's go back to Service Desk Plus and look at the first point I mentioned, which is assigning a workstation and mapping them to your end users. So let's jump back to the Assets tab. Let's go and look at a workstation. So let's scroll down. You can see how easy it is for me to track down a workstation, right? Because of these categories. So these are just a couple of ways which makes life easier for you and just a quick hacks for you. So now if I click on this workstation, immediately I can see that this workstation is assigned to Sriram. So now let's look at a couple of ways this is useful. So now let's say Sriram creates a new ticket. So now most of the times technicians, right? They have to constantly, there's a back and forth with the requester, right? Your technician, most of the time requesters, they just don't give the necessary information. Now your technician is having to reach out to the requester and ask them, hey, can you tell me the specifications of your asset and so on, right? So now you can eliminate all that easily by assigning your workstation to your end user. So now when a ticket is created by Sriram, the technician just can just go ahead and click on the workstation that is associated to him, and he can get all this different information about that particular asset. So he can see the hardware details, the software, the relationships, and also he can see all tickets that are associated to this particular workstation. Like I was telling you earlier, if one workstation has 10 incidents that it has associated to it over the years, then it definitely means that it could probably be a problem workstation and it's high time you replace them. And another thing is you can associate your assets to your changes and problems as well so that you can track and you can easily assess the impact of that particular change or problem on your organization just by clicking on the asset and by seeing the different relationships of this particular asset. So that is why it's important that you associate your tickets to your assets. So over here, let's say this particular asset is associated to a change. I can just go ahead and click on the relationships of this asset when I'm doing my impact analysis, and I can see how important this particular asset is. So I can see all the different business services, components, assets, and the user it is connected to. So this is one way, this is a small place where you can see the benefits of a CMDB. So now let's go ahead and look at in detail what a CMDB can do for you. So let's go over to the CMDB tab over here. And over here, we can see that you have a list of all these different categories over here. So what you can do is basically under each of these categories, you can create a detailed relationship map to map the different connections or relationships each asset has for themselves. So let's say if you're going to look at a data center, you can create a brief map to identify all the relationships of this particular data center. So it gives you a bird's eye view of how this particular data center or workstation or user's relationship map looks like. So that is how, so this is one way through which you can create these individual maps. Another thing you can do with the CMDB is build business views. So let's say you build a business view for your email services. You can build a detailed relationship map to map out all the relationships, all the assets that are required to keep this particular service running. So whenever this service, let's say this service, particular service goes down, by looking at this relationship map, you can identify what could have caused this service to go down. And let's say if this main server has gone down, you can identify all the different applications that it is affecting, and you can actually create a very well thought out impact analysis, and you can easily, or it'll help you get to the root cause of this problem a little easier. So this is why you need a CMDB, and only by collecting all your asset details and mapping them using the CMDB, you're actually building this this process where you can collect all this information that you need and easily get the information you need in case of, let's say, you have an unexpected downtime. Using this map, you can identify what could have caused this issue. So that is the CMDB. Now, finally, let's look at the different integrations available to you in Service Desk Plus. So we have already seen the SCCM integration. So that is one way through which you can bring information or you can import data from your Microsoft SCCM application. Now let's look at two other integrations that we give you, native integrations that we provide for you. So one is MDM, which is our Mobile Device Manager Plus application, which is a product of ManageEngine. In case you didn't know, we also provide an integration with Desktop Central. So these are two applications that collect asset information. Now Mobile Device Manager specializes in collecting information about your smartphones and tablets and manage them better. And Desktop Central also can collect a lot more detailed information about your assets. Now, using these integrations, you can actually pull in data from these applications into your Service Desk Plus application. So these are a couple of ways through which you can leverage the capabilities of these other ManageEngine products and bring them into Service Desk Plus so that you have everything you need to manage your IT your asset infrastructure in your organization. So that pretty much brings us to the end of the fifth hack. Now let's quickly look at the challenges that Zilker faced and how Service Desk Plus actually helped them overcome the features in Service Desk Plus that helped them overcome these challenges. So the first one is the inability to track asset usage, and for that we have our asset life cycles and the asset states. So difficulty raising purchase orders and tracking vendor contracts, we saw how Zilker streamlined that entire process with purchase and contract management and the ability to associate them to assets and service requests as well. Next up, we saw how multiple scanning methods helped Zilker bring in all the different kinds of assets they had into Service Desk Plus. Next up, we saw how software management, the software assets dashboards and license management capabilities in Service Desk Plus help Zilker track their software license efficiently and also stay compliant. Next up, we saw how the CMDB, the asset associations, and using reports, Zilker can optimize their asset usage to ensure that they have just the right amount of assets they need for their organization, and also how they can map their asset relationships and identify the relationships of the assets with the rest of their IT infrastructure. And finally, we saw how the reports modules and the custom asset dashboards that we saw right at the beginning can help Zilker generate the reports that they need, collect the right metrics that they want, and help them continuously improve their IT asset management process. Okay, so now it's time for a quick recap. So we saw how purchase orders, contracts help Zilker procure their assets better. We saw how they discovered and inventoried all their assets using the different scan techniques, how they were able to identify, categorize assets with the customizations available, how they were able to track relationships and manage their financials, how they could allocate assets to users, track these assets throughout their entire life cycle. We also saw how Zilker could stay compliant, manage their software efficiently, and how this helps them ace their audits now that they have all their asset information. We also saw how they can set up software license expiries and ensure that their software license are not expired and their end users' workflows are not affected. We also saw how you can integrate your IT asset management with the rest of the ITSM processes to build a holistic ITSM in your organization with and leverage the information that your IT asset management gives you. And finally, we saw how you can continuously improve your IT asset management by tracking related KPIs and other metrics as well. So basically, these are the five hacks that we saw today, and I hope you can go ahead and use these hacks in your organization as well and make your IT asset management so much better. So guys, that pretty much brings us to the end of the session. If you want to know more about Services Plus, you have these different resources available for you. You have the admin guide where you can get more info about the product. You have our release notes where you can get more information about all our new releases. And we have a variety of product videos that explains various Services Plus features. So please do go check them out. And our community, you can use the community to connect with your peers and connect with us as well. And if you have any questions, you can ask them over there and we'd be happy to help. We have our support portal URL over here. And as always, write to us at hello@servicedeskplus.com for any questions. If you need any help implementing or using these hacks in your organization, please do write to us and we'd be happy to help you. And once again, guys, thank you for taking the time to be here. I hope this was a useful session for you and you learned a couple of hacks and tricks that you can implement in your organization to make your IT asset management so much more better. And I hope I see you in the next session. Please do stay tuned for more info about the next session. And once again, have a great day, guys, and thank you for taking the time to be here. Thank you very much.